Maybe a journal if you're a note taker. Let's make sure. Okay, perfect. Being live streamed. And we will be recording the video just for your awareness in case you want to keep your camera on or off for that reason. Honor your privacy. As everyone gets situated, I'd love to hear what is your top show to watch right now, or book to read, or album or song that we all need to listen to before the end of the year? I want to see these in the chat if you're comfortable sharing.
For me, I love Trevor Jackson. He just released a new EP. So good.
My book recommendation is Leo Kalyan, Leokalyan. They have a new song out called Diamond Life, and it's all about how you don't have to be rich to feel worthy. So good.
Woof.
All right.
Look at these in the comments.
I'm really enjoying Lizzie McAlpine's new album. It's absolutely gorgeous. She's also coming to my city on her tour this summer, so I'm definitely getting tickets. So if you haven't heard it, please listen to it.
Amazing.
Come through. Ooh. I'm seeing a lot of TV shows. Like, people are
Yes.
really going crazy. Amelie in Paris, season three is coming. So excited.
Did anybody watch Wednesday?
That's what I want to talk about. Wednesday!
I didn't see it
So
yet.
good.
This is amazing.
So good.
I'm gonna have to save this chat and just post all of the recommendations so
Yes.
we're sorted for
Somebody said Wednesday, and I'm into it. I'm loving that.
Yes.
Carissa, what's up? Hi, Hannah.
Hey everyone, again, great to have you. We're gonna get started in just a couple of minutes. In the meantime, as you share your favorite recommendations, would also love to ask this question. If you could describe how you're currently feeling about today's workshop, in like one or a few words, how are you feeling? No right or wrong answers, no expectations. Yes, pumped, excited, curious, intrigued. Right? You're like, what are we actually getting into? Amazing.
I'm seeing so many people who are beyond excited. It's like a sense of community,
Yes.
supported,
Oh,
aligned.
love it.
I like that.
Smiling visibly, how sweet. And Ruba, do you have a follow-up question?
Do I have a follow-up question? I want to know where everybody's watching from. Hit us up in the comment section. I want to know. We got Dallas, San Francisco, we got ATL. What up, ATL? San Diego, we have Japan. Arigato gozaimasu. We have Baltimore, Singapore, Colorado, Philly, what up? I'm from Pittsburgh. I love it. Seattle, I hope it's not raining. Hopefully, you guys are staying warm and bundled up. Canada, I love poutine. That's like one of my favorite snacks. We have Quebec, we have Chicago.
Yes, this is
Chi-town.
amazing. All
Hi.
right. I think we should go ahead and get started. Okay, cool. So, this is, yes, we'll save this song for later. Like, okay, Dre. So, yes, let's get started. This is such a special time to be in this space, and we're exploring really essential topics, so thank you for being here. For those of you who don't know, I'm Allison Stoner. For our blind and low vision attendees, I'm a female, non-binary person sitting in my home office wearing comfy clothes that I wore yesterday. Oops. I'm the founder of Movement Genius, and we're a digital platform where you can find stress relief techniques, mental health tools, and guided movement classes to improve your well-being anytime, anywhere. And we really believe that everyone deserves to feel safe and comfortable and confident in their mind and body, and that you deserve to have access to these helpful tools at your fingertips so you can manage stress and whatever the day brings. So every quarter, we throw these fun, meaningful workshops, and I'm gonna be one of your hosts for today's Self-Care for Queer Folks workshop alongside Rubo Wilson. That sounds like a cat. Supposed to be a siren.
Yeah, I'm here for it. Now, if you guys just joined, like Miss Allison said, I am Rubo Wilson. It is so great to have all of you guys. Please get comfortable, grab a snack, a blanket, all of that good stuff. We will begin in just a few minutes. Once again, grab anything that you guys may need and a journal. A journal is so important because we have some amazing speakers. They are literally going to be dropping so many gems that you are going to want to jot down. Yes. Got it? And really quick, just to give you guys a visual of me, I have long dreads. I'm in a very comfy flannel with some UGG pants, and I'm just vibing out right now. It's beautiful.
So Ruba, if you wanna give us a little overview of what to expect today, because we've got a lot in store.
All right. Now, listen, we have so many amazing speakers. We have Blair Imani. We have a really cool movement exercise where we're going to be able to allow you guys to really get into your bodies. And, you know, we are in the holiday season where we are, you know, dealt with so many different things, seasonal depression. We have, you know, going back home where, you know, family members might not necessarily make you feel comfortable. So we're giving you all of the tools that you guys ultimately need during this time to really celebrate who you are and to, you know, really understand where you are as a being. So once again, there's gonna be so many great things. We have giveaways, we have amazing speakers. It's going to be jam packed. I'm so excited for you guys to hear all the talks. We have Q&As. Giveaways, and trust me, you guys do not want to miss.
Yeah, so I'll get into some of the specifics. We're gonna do our first giveaway right off the bat, and then after, I'm gonna lead a grounding practice just to help us drop into the present. Ty recorded a special mini stress relief session, and then after, Blair is going to be chatting about supporting yourselves through the holidays. Kaylee is going to lead a quick stretch and movement break, and then you can submit your community questions for the Q&A. And just a couple notes to make. First, accessibility-wise, as you see, we have two ASL interpreters. Hello, and thank you, Brandon and Candace, as well as live captioning enabled. And we're also going to announce who's speaking for anyone who is blind and low vision. So if we can make something more comfortable and suitable for you, just please send us a direct message. We'd love to do that. Next, the topics that we're covering today are quite personal. They're quite complex. So it's important to really create a safe space together. You can keep your camera on or off. You can choose to communicate in the chat or not. But here are the guidelines. Honor and respect your needs. Honor and respect other people's needs, period. it's not every day that we get to be in this kind of community with so many queer folks. So let's cherish this and create that accepting, wonderful space. If you can't participate in this way and you cross some lines, you will be removed. Sorry about that, but not sorry.
Listen, it is what it is. Yeah. Now, should something inappropriate happen or you guys need support, you guys can private message the box labeled Safety Monitor. Also, if you guys want to submit a question for the Q&A, message Movement Genius, or pretty simple, add it to the chat. Now, finally, there's one reason that this workshop can be free, and that is because we have the coolest sponsors, starting with IME, which offers free guides built for the queer teens to help you explore your identity and support your mental health. Second, WISP, you shout out to WISP, which offers hassle-free sexual health care, including STI testing and treatment, birth control, medical abortion, and meds. Lastly, Queen Capital, a lesbian-owned real estate group. Thank you guys so much.
Shout out to the lesbians. Woo, woo. Hey. All right, who's ready for the first giveaway? Okay, so as Rua mentioned, IME is a free resource and space where you can discover who you are at your own pace, particularly geared towards queer teens. But they are offering 10 lucky winners a swag bag with a $50 gift card, LGBTQ plus artist stickers and posters, a tote bag, and pins. So, drumroll please. Early winners are Milo Parker. I hope I pronounce this correctly. Yael, Y-A-E-L. Mae Nicholson. Caden. Eliza. Sophie Merritt. Jesse Hoots. Please forgive me as I work through this one.
You got this, boo.
Lucine Garibian. You get a melody. And Danny, just Dane. And Olivia Burke. Congratulations!
Congrats, guys.
Okay, so I invite you to set aside any distractions and allow yourself to be here with us now. Let's do a little grounding practice. No worries if you don't have any experience. That's why we are building a little toolkit. So grounding can help if you're feeling anxious or stressed or just disconnected and you want to come back into the present. Don't worry, you don't have to sit perfectly still. So if it's helpful for you to move a little bit, stretch, just do your thing. So go ahead, find a comfortable position where you can feel your feet connected to the ground or your body connected to a surface like a chair or couch or bed. Nice, okay. And as you settle, just allow your knees to soften. Let your shoulders start to relax. Maybe unclenching your jaw. And then if you want to just give your full body a gentle wiggle to loosen any stiffness. Yeah. And let your eyes wander around the room, just noticing the details of the space. Some shapes, colors that are around you. And if sight isn't available, begin listening to sounds that are close by and further away. Nice. Now shifting to our sense of touch. Notice different things that you are touching. So it could be clothes on your skin or the floor under you? How do the textures feel right now? What's the temperature? And now let's focus on the sense of smell, which is really just an invitation to take some deep breaths. How does the air smell around you? So while we're here, take a few moments to connect with your breath and just follow its natural rhythm, letting it flow in and out, filling your body, releasing. Nice. And just let yourself land here a bit more. If you notice any thoughts or emotions arise, that's totally normal. Just let each breath help you come into the present a little bit more. Awesome. So as we continue to let ourselves land, I am going to throw it over to Ty, who recorded this really special stress relief session for us. And if you don't know, Ty is a trans, non-binary actor, singer, and content creator. I follow them. I don't know if you already follow them. They make educational and queer-affirming content. So let me make sure I share my screen and bring up Ty for us. And I'm going to be joining you as well. So let's do it.
Hello, beautiful people. My name is Ty. My pronouns are they and she, and it is so wonderful to be a part of this workshop. I know that the holidays can be a stressful time for a lot of queer folks, so I think it is so beautiful that we all have this opportunity to come together in the name of self-care and self-love and lift each other up. So now that we are beginning to ground, I wanted to share some stress relief techniques that you can use anytime, whether you're in public, on the go, or at home. They can also come in clutch during stressful holiday situations. Just think of today as a casual sampler of techniques. Try what you want, keep what you like, and let go of the rest. Follow along at a pace that feels good and helpful for you today. Each of these tools will help bring more awareness to our mind and body. So it's totally normal if you notice thoughts, emotions, or sensations arise. Simply notice them with curiosity. However, if anything feels unmanageable, pause and take a break. So let's begin with five finger breathing. This is a personal favorite because you can do this subtly without anyone knowing. It involves connecting your breath to the motion of your hands tracing up and down your fingers. If your fingers are not available, you can trace a different body part. To begin, hold out a hand. I'll keep mine up so you can see, but you can have it in your lap if you want. Take the opposite hand with your pointer finger and begin tracing up the pinky as you inhale. As you reach the top, come back down on the other side and exhale. Or repeat this on each finger, really taking your time, feeling the sensations, tracing up on the inhale, tracing down on the exhale. There's no rush here. Bringing your attention to this experience. As you move towards the final finger, just notice what comes up for you. Okay, if you'd like, we can do the other hand or a different body part. This time, if you're up for it, see if you can elongate your inhale and exhale with each finger. So if you inhale for three counts on the first finger, perhaps try counting to four on the next. When you're ready, begin. Feeling the gentle connection between your hands. Slowing down. Feeling your hand trace every millimeter. Relaxing into this. Feeling your breath deepen. And as you reach the end of this hand, you're welcome to continue this technique or take a nice deep breath to reset. And we'll get into the next tip. Okay, you may be feeling more calm or more anxious, so just continue to meet yourself where you are and listen to your body. This next technique helps us shake off the stress and anxiety. Have you ever seen an animal who freezes when they're in danger? After the threat is done, they shake off the extra adrenaline and energy in their bodies. This helps complete the stress response cycle. Otherwise, if they don't release it, that moment can get stuck in their bodies as trauma and cause them to be more vulnerable next time it happens. So for us, a lot of times after stressful situations, we don't give ourselves a chance to complete the cycle, meaning we never release the energy and come back to neutral. It just gets stuck. So a simple solution is to shake off the stress. You can do this standing, but today we'll try it seated. Now begin to gently bounce to get some motion. It may feel a little stiff or even odd at first, that's normal. Just let the bounce help loosen up any tightness. Loosening your spine, relaxing your stomach so it can move a little more freely. Allow the bounce to reach your upper body and shoulders, arms, and even your neck and head, almost becoming more like a noodle. Okay, now, with your right hand, gently shake, feeling stress and tension flick off your hands. Moving up into the elbow, shaking, letting go. Now shaking and wiggling through your right upper arm and shoulder, perhaps even letting it swing forward and back or move around randomly, whatever feels helpful. Now while your right arm is shaking, begin to shake your left hand, breathing deeply, loosening the wrist up to the elbow, shaking gently, wiggling, releasing. Sometimes stranger the movement, the better it feels. Into the upper arm and shoulders, shaking any direction. Now, if you'd like, you can begin shaking through your lower body as well. For a little longer, just shaking out whatever tension or emotions want to release. Now on the count of three, slowly return to a neutral position, breathing deeply. One, two, let it out. Three. Setting into stillness or light sway. Dropping your shoulders, and if you'd like, placing one hand on your chest, the other on your stomach. Softening your gaze or even closing your eyes. Notice what's present in your body. Any thoughts or emotions? Perhaps feeling your heartbeat. Your lungs expanding and contracting. Maybe some buzzing or tingling. If this has stirred up some things, you can continue shaking to release, or join me as we move into the third technique, bilateral tapping. Now, you can either alternate tapping your legs left and right, or crossing your arms like a hug, tapping left and right. or crossing your hands on your chest like a butterfly, tapping left and right. Now go ahead and pick where you'd like to tap and change anytime. Begin finding a rhythm that feels really good and soothing. This side-to-side motion helps activate both sides of our brain, logic, and emotions. Allow this movement to help you come back into your full self, your mind and heart beginning to expand, softening your face, maybe even daring to bring the slightest grin to your face. Now keep going. If you'd like, you can repeat these affirmations after me. It is okay to be honest with how I'm feeling. I am supporting myself one moment at a time. I am safe to relax a bit more. With every breath, I invite more ease and peace. I can move through today, one moment at a time. Excellent. Let's pause here for a moment. Now, I told you we do a sampler of a couple techniques, so you can pick any one of these and focus on it for 5 or 10 minutes. But for now, there's only one more left. You can continue tapping or feel free to try the last one with me. This is called progressive muscle relaxation, and it's a little counterintuitive. Instead of telling ourselves to relax, we're actually going to tighten our muscles first and then completely release. It helps us because we become aware of where we hold stress and how it feels, so then we can consciously release the tension. Today, we'll just do 3 brief rounds. Beginning with your arms and shoulders, shrug your shoulders up, bend your arms at the elbows, and clench your fists. Inhale, and tighten this area, gripping and holding as strongly as you can manage. If anything feels painful, release some of the intensity. Holding tight, you may even notice a little shaking. Focus on the feelings in your shoulders and your arms. Feel the sensation holding. And on the count of 3, we're going to release completely from 100 to 0. 1, 2, 3, exhale and release. Reconnect with your breath here for a moment. A new level of relaxation unlocked. Memorizing this feeling. Let's repeat this again. This time, if you'd like to add in your lower body, glutes, legs, feet, feel free to do so. On your next inhale, begin tightening your upper and lower body. Squeezing your hands, shoulders, abdomen, glutes, thighs, holding. And now, on the count of 3, all at once, exhale and release the tension completely. Ready? 1, 2, 3, release. Even more, like a deflated balloon. Absolute effortlessness. Now, this final round, if you'd like, feel free to add in your face and neck, scrunching them as we tighten. Okay, begin holding. Scrunching your face, tightening your fists, shrug your shoulders, clench your abdomen, engage your glutes, calves, feet, letting whatever is going on in your life have its moment to be seen, acknowledged, felt. And on the count of 3, abruptly letting everything go more than ever. Ready? 1, 2, exhale and release. 3, softening. A little more. A little more. Let a wave of relaxation wash over your face, neck, shoulders, arms and core. Lower body and feet, yielding to the calm, yielding to rest, allowing yourself to be held, breathing here in this space, in and out, in. When you're ready, ease your focus back into the room. Now, you've just learned four techniques: five-finger breathing, shaking off the stress, bilateral tapping, and progressive muscle relaxation. I know that was a lot, but I just wanted you to be set up with some tools. All of these and more are on Movement Genius, so be sure to check them out whenever you need. Please let us know in the chat how you're feeling, which of the techniques felt most helpful today. Which one would you use during the holidays or stressful situations? It truly has been a joy to share this time and space with you. The way that we love ourselves is by honoring our needs, and in the times where it's most challenging, remember there is an entire community here to lift you up. Sending so much love to you this holiday season. Take care.
That was so beautiful. Thank you, Ty. I wanna know from all of you guys, from all of you beautiful people, how are you feeling? Which of these techniques were most helpful? I'm currently feeling beyond relaxed. I feel free. I feel like all of the stresses from the last month have pretty much gone away. Now, I just wanna know, I want all of you guys to know that there are a few of hundreds of tools that you guys can use anytime. And we want you guys to be set up and ready. So here's a special link in the chat to get you guys a full year of access to these tools for only $10 total. Allison?
Yes, I wanna see how everyone's feeling. I do wanna acknowledge that sometimes if you're trying a stress relief technique, it might not immediately bring relief. It might actually stir up things. You might even find yourself having out-of-body experiences. And so if that's the case, one, if it feels unmanageable, pause. That just might not be the tool that's helpful right now. Two, this entire process, the core of it is building that relationship between your mind and body. So if you listen and you ask yourself, like, what do I need right now? And start to rebuild that trust, then you can start experimenting with which tools actually help you feel relaxed or energized, right? Because we all have a different nervous system. Every moment is different. Every day is different. So really honor what you need in this time. I want to see some of the responses saying five-finger breathing and bilateral tapping. Awesome. Love seeing that there's a community space plus one for the five-finger breathing. Yes. Shaking hands. Yes, I love imagining actually the stress, like, releasing off your body. It's so relieving. This is amazing. And yes, I know that I put it in the chat, but I'll do it again here. That is our $10 deal for an entire year, because we want you to be set up. So let's see. I'm so excited for what's about to happen. We are about to bring onto the stage Blair Imani. So Blair is a queer, bisexual, Muslim author, historian, and activist. She's the author of Read This to Get Smarter, which I have on my shelf right there, and the creator of Smarter in Seconds, which is one of my favorite Instagram and social media series that exists. Today, she's going to help us break down how to support ourselves as queer people for the holidays, but also just to get through life. So let's make this interactive. Please feel free, share your thoughts, do the plus ones if something is resonating. Get cozy and please give a warm welcome to Blair and Moni.
Thank you all so much. That was such a beautiful discussion from Ty. I always have to slow down my speech. As many of you know, I have ADHD. And so sometimes for me, that means that I go on fast forward. I want to thank you, Brandon, Kaz, and Maddox for doing my ASL, as I like to say. Thank you for helping me. That's some ASL that I learned from Blue's Clues, that show. I'm also in the business now of creating cartoons, and I've been really looking at how we can use early childhood education and those kind of things that feel more youthful and new and fresh to us to heal ourselves. But one thing I've been very interested in recently, and I was telling Allison about this when they were talking to me about how to, what we should talk about today, is active language. Now, active language is a little bit different. I see, yes, Lucine talking about this is different than active voice. Active voice and passive voice, those things have to do with grammar. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, Jesse. Blue's Clues has ASL. This is like the one from the 90s. But anyway, active language or direct language are ways that we can speak directly and actively about what we're going through. So when it comes to being an LGBTQ plus person, such as myself, I'm bisexual. Bisexuals, holla in the chat. Sometimes we're told that we're being bullied, or we're experiencing harassment or violence because we're bisexual or trans or queer or a lesbian or gay. But the fact is, we're existing. We are simply being in the world. And we are experiencing things because the people who are perpetrating that against us are biphobic, transphobic, homophobic. And that might seem like a small shift, but what it really does is get to the core of, you know, what Ty was talking about was grounding our physical beings, and instead, and moving toward grounding our mental and emotional beings. I'm going to take you on a little journey now, and let me introduce myself as well. I forgot, because we have, you know, we're trying to be accommodating to blind and low vision folks. I am a lighter skinned Black person. I am wearing a ruby lip color. I have a shirt that is giving sunset. It has all of those nice tones. I'm wearing a very nice, very soft lavender turban. I have my pink Apple AirPods Max, hashtag not sponsored. And I'm in a cabin in upstate New York. So there's kind of a wood panel behind me. So that's a visual description for you as well. Something that we can always reinforce. So when it comes to grounding our emotional selves, I think about what I've learned from nature. Now, whether you call it Mother Nature or just nature, I like to have like that maternal sense. I think about this metaphor of birds and sloths. So birds, also their pooping habits, but we're going to talk about this in a way where we consider this poop to be kind of emotional baggage. So birds, I mean, raise your hand in the chat if you have been inconvenienced by a bird that had to go potty. That has definitely been me. I see you, yes, Allison. I see you, Fontana, Liz, Megan, yes. I mean, people tell you it's good luck, but I feel like sometimes people just tell you it's good luck so that way you feel better about something happening. Anyway, if we consider this to be our emotional baggage, birds don't care who you are, where you are, what you're wearing, what day it is. When they need to go, they're going to go. Now, sloths, on the other hand, the only time that sloths, which are one of the slowest animals, which I'm trying to channel right now so I can talk slow to make Brandon's life easier. Thank you again. Sloths, the only time that they climb down from their trees is to go number two or to give birth, which is interesting. That also happens to be the only time that they are attacked by predators because they're vulnerable. And if we can think of that number two as their emotional baggage, we can consider how much of a personal toll it takes on them to pause from their day, pause from their busy habits, and deal with that, to deal with their emotional baggage, even if it means that it's going to cost them something, versus birds who don't care and who will ruin your day if their day is ruined. There are a lot of people in the world who, because they don't have the resources to do that, because they haven't been able to connect with Allison and Movement Genius to have those amazing resources that are basically free at $10 a year, to deal with that emotional baggage. And so, Parker, you're hilarious in the chat for that. But basically thinking about how there are sloths in the world who deal with their mess, who deal with their crap, and birds who put it on other people. Unfortunately, a lot of our homophobic relatives are in the position of being those birds. It doesn't mean that we excuse it, but it can help us to understand it, to understand that there are a lot of people in our lives. I actually was just talking about this with a friend of mine recently who was having a quote unquote, and this is me with air quotes, hard time figuring out pronouns, as someone who is understanding his own bisexuality, as someone who is reconciling internalized toxic masculinity and wanting to wear lipstick. And so what did that look like? It looked like him being a bird and misgendering one of my close friends. Does that mean it's okay? No. Does that mean we can understand where it came from? Potentially, yes. And so when it comes to understanding our own emotional regulation, that's what this whole thing is called. When we determine and understand our own emotional frequencies and figure out how we can be the best for other people, we can recognize where it comes from and have compassion and empathy, but we can also hold those boundaries for ourselves. And that takes into a discussion of boundaries. And I also just love, just quickly, I came up with this kind of metaphor while I was in the forest, where I'm kind of, you know, in the I'm in the woods up in upstate New York. And when I was in the forest in Costa Rica, I saw sloths taking their sweet time at great expense to them and birds just flapping around. It also helps that I'm afraid of birds. That's like my one big fear, that and white supremacy. But it's like one of those things where I kind of imprinted that thing myself, but I'm glad it's making sense to you all. And so when it comes to setting boundaries, we do this all the time. One of the great ways that we set boundaries is asking people if they've seen a movie before we talk about it. And you may have experienced this recently, particularly with the new Black Panther film coming out. Sometimes people will say, oh, have you seen the new Black Panther? I'd love to talk about it. And we wait to see if other people are ready to talk about that too. If they haven't seen it, they'll say, oh my gosh, I haven't seen it. No spoilers, please. And you'll be like, cool, I understand. And we generally respect that. But when it comes to things like something violent, you know, perhaps talking about something like the recent harms that happened in Colorado, before people will go into graphic detail, people generally don't stop and say, hey, are you cool with talking about this? Why? Because we're socialized to tell people to suck it up, to be like, no, you can't handle it, that's on you. Instead of checking in with people to see if they have the capacity to be a bird or to be a sloth. And so we have to practice and exercise that muscle that we already have, that boundary setting. And I promise you, you already know how to do it. Who has a food allergy or any type of allergy? I have so many of them. When you go to a restaurant, if that's something that you experience, or you're going to a gathering with friends, you might be rehearsed or practice it saying, actually, I'm allergic to nuts. Actually, I can't have that. And you bring it up with kind of, somebody said lactose intolerant. I love that instead of lactose intolerant. That's cute. We're very rehearsed and practiced at expressing our needs. So this isn't something we have to learn. We just have to figure out amongst our friends and family members how we can express those needs and those concerns in a way that keeps us safe and secure. Now, how does this relate to self-care and queerness and the holidays? So I'm Muslim, so my holiday season was actually 6 months ago, but I'm in an interfaith family, so I will be observing Christmas and Hanukkah and Kwanzaa. Well, I'm not celebrating them. I'm gonna be observing those. So yes, I love a little intersectional moment, little interfaith moment. And so what that looks like for me is, as an educator, so often, and this happened all of Thanksgiving, my family members will have waited for a moment to talk to me, the queerness expert, on something. For one of my cousins that was talking to me about Zaya Wade and Dwayne Wade and what that meant. I happened to be in that kind of mind space to allow that conversation to happen and to be helpful in that. But sometimes we don't want to be thought experiments. We just want to be human beings and we want to enjoy our apple pie. And so how do we apply that to those moments? Well, the first thing is to recognize that you have the right to simply exist. And you have the right to set boundaries. But this is the real world. And unfortunately, a lot of us don't have the room or the space or permission or safety to express those boundaries. So how do you prepare yourselves in those moments? How many of you have had to sit through a conversation that was uncomfortable, that you wanted to leave, but you couldn't? All the time. So how do you save yourself through it? Things that you can do are those progressive muscle relaxations that Ty talked about, because that way you know when you're holding stress in your shoulders or in your tummy, you know what it feels like. So when you're in a conversation with, I don't know, your Auntie Karen, like my Auntie Karen, you can remember what that feels like and recognize that you're under stress. You can also recognize and affirm within yourself, even if you can't do it out loud, that you don't deserve to be in those situations. You can have compassion and empathy for the people who maybe don't have the time, space, or resources to process their feelings in a healthy way, like a sloth. They only have time to be a bird. And you can remember that you deserve better. Snoop Dogg recently released a series of affirmations. I happen to watch all of the cartoons because I'm a cartoon person. I produce cartoons now. And he has a saying, there is no one better to be than myself. And reminding yourself that you have done so much work to come to where you are. You have made such great strides in growing, whether that's going to therapy, whether that's signing up for Movement Genius, whether it's participating in this discussion. You are literally doing something right now that there are so many people who are afraid to do. There are so many people who don't know that this exists. And you are taking that step. You are investing in yourself. And by investing in yourself, you're investing in the people around you because you're helping them to see a person who is becoming emotionally regulated, who is working on themselves, who is being somebody who is strong and powerful. But there's also another side. And I think that as a bisexual Muslim, I have had a lot of compassion and empathy for the people who can't be out. Now, obviously, you don't have to raise your hand if you're not out. But who remembers, if you do want to speak up, what it was like to be a queer person who couldn't declare their queerness? Maybe you're in that boat right now. Right now, we live in a world where we emphasize people who are out, where we say, you have the bravery to live your truth. Even the phrase live your truth is so loaded because it says that somebody who isn't out is living a lie. That's not true. Because somebody assumed something of you, so for example, I talk to a lot of parents of LGBTQ kids. And they'll say to me, well, I just don't understand why Stephanie won't come out. Well, what do you mean? Well, Stephanie's clearly a lesbian and she's lying to me. Stephanie's 12. Maybe it's the fact that you're assuming that Stephanie should be straight and Stephanie's actually queer. So perhaps it's your assumptions that are the problem and not the fact that Stephanie hasn't said she's out. Because we should not be forced to live somebody else's script and play somebody else's role if we can't say who we are. That's something that's been taken away from us. And one thing I like to talk about is you already know who you are. You have been taught to doubt yourself. You don't have to find yourself because you are yourself. But these are a lot of affirmations that are taken away from us. Reem said, living in the closet is very brave. And it is. Because for a lot of us, it means having to witness and experience people telling us they don't like our community. And us having to kind of sit there and grit our teeth in silence and be brave in the face of that. But it doesn't mean that you are living a lie. It means that you are living your truth and that other people are making assumptions about you. And that's not your responsibility. You're not being bullied because you're LGBTQ+. You're being bullied because of their anti-LGBTQ+ hate. If you are only out to yourself and your stuffed animals or your dog or your cat or your hamster, that is enough. It doesn't mean you aren't having access to community. It doesn't mean that you have to prove yourself. It means that you are surviving. And I really think that's what these holiday seasons can remind us. We are all out here surviving. And anything else we do beyond that is a gift. If we can be an example to other people, if we can be somebody who endures that and is somebody else that shows somebody, hey, there is a path forward, that's beautiful. But if all you are doing is simply breathing in your air, living with those resources, surviving, that is more than enough. I also want the folks who are out, who maybe feel like they're not queer enough, and anybody who regardless of your semi-outness, outness, being closeted, being private even, because there's a difference there, to think about yourself 5 years ago. Think about the version of yourself that aspired to be where you are now. Be proud of that. I'm making myself emotional. You are doing things now that you never could have imagined, that you didn't dare to utter from your lips because you thought it might jinx it. And you're doing that. And maybe you're in that moment now. You're in a caterpillar phase where you're learning and you're absorbing and you're growing. Maybe you're in your cocoon phase, or your chrysalis phase, if you're scholarly. Maybe you're in your butterfly phase. There are all these aspects of who you are, and maybe language can't even define it. That's okay. That doesn't matter. All that matters is that you know exactly who you are. You have just been taught to doubt yourself. You do not have to be out in order to be validly queer, and that you are loved and you are worthy simply because you exist. So we have grounded our bodies with tie, and inshallah, which means God willing in Arabic, we have grounded our mental and emotional states. We know that bravery is not simply being public about your identity, but also being private, or somewhere in between. And inshallah, you know that you already have the tools and resources to set those boundaries, to know that you deserve better than what you have been given. And that while our goal is to be emotionally regulated like the sloth, we might be birds from time to time. All of these things live within us and more. And to me, that is so exciting. Because while we might not have the time to share who we are, the fullness of who we are with everybody, we can share it with ourselves. And that is more than enough. That is a gift that only you can give yourself. So if you can, I would love for you all to hug your shoulders. Give yourself that hug. And remember that you have permission to hold yourself, to cuddle yourself, to affirm yourself, to nurture yourself. And while it is nice to have those things from other people, that is always a gift that you can give to yourself. And I want you to say your name, I'll go first, and that you are worthy and that you are loved. Blair, you are worthy. Blair, you are loved. And please do that for yourself. And so when you go home, if you are going home for the holidays, if at any point you are in a time or space where you are not affirmed by other people, I want you to find the closest alleyway, the closest literal closet, the closest bathroom, and give that gift to yourself. And I don't care if it seems weird. I don't care if it seems out of the box. It is necessary, and it is something that you deserve, and it is something that you can give to yourself. Because you are loved and you are worthy. And if nobody tells you that, you can tell yourself. And it is true. I believe in every single one of you. I am so proud of every single one of you. And I am so grateful to have been able to share time with you, albeit virtually. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Blair. My heart is so open.
It was beautiful. I'm screaming.
You can tell I grew up in the church. Sometimes I'd be taking some sermons out here.
So good. Everything.
Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of love in the chat. Feel free. I am a huge believer in letting someone know how they are, you know, inspiring you in real time. Please show Blair some love and appreciation.
Yes.
So just taking a moment to revel in that. I know that we've been sitting maybe in the same position for a while, and I do want to give us an opportunity to take a quick break and move our bodies, or go to the bathroom, do whatever you need. But for those who are staying, we do have a special guest, Kaylee, who is going to guide a little stretch and movement break. I want to invite you to hold on to this feeling that Blair and Ty are helping us generate, and maybe stretch in that space, move in that space. If you're grabbing a snack, whatever you're doing, maybe allow this space to continue and just practice it, because if and when we're in another situation a week from now, we can recall this from our body memory, right? So I invite you to stay in that yummy space if it's yummy. And then after, we'll have our community Q&A. So I want to hear from you all. If you have questions, you can direct message them to the box labeled Movement Genius, or you can just throw them in the chat. So I'm going to put on some music here. Oh, hey, and I will also let Kaylee introduce their friend, and let me share my audio. And without further ado, Kaylee.
Hi, friends. Hello, hello. I am Kaylee. I use she, her pronouns, and I am also queer, and I am so, so excited to be here dancing with all of you today. Today, I want you to allow yourself to relax. And again, thank you, Blair, for everything that you just gave this conversation and to my soul. And with that being said, I also have Nayana here. Nayana, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Nayana Marie, and I use she, her pronouns.
Nayana will be assisting me. I am a wheelchair user. I am a dance educator, and Nayana will be demonstrating the standing version of this groove that we're gonna go through together. So if you're ready, go ahead and prepare yourself for dance, whatever that looks like for you. For me, I am seated In my wheelchair, Nayana will be standing. If you want to go through this movement exercise with me from seated, you're more than welcome to. Standing, whatever you need to make this accessible for you, do let us know if you need anything else from there. With that being said, let's get moving. Let's go, friends.
All right,
I'm going to angle this down just a little bit. All right, everyone, let's go ahead and count. Keep going. Just find your center, find your group. Good. We're going to take the foot up to the side. You're stepping out with your foot on your floor. Bouncing. Good. Now step side to side. We're stepping to the side and bringing that foot to the other one underneath. Side to side. Now step. And lunge in place. Let's take two chucks to the front. Chuck, chuck, step, step. Chuck, chuck, step, step. Chuck, chuck, step, step. And chuck, chuck, step, step. Chuck, chuck, step, step. Chuck, chuck, step, step. One more time. And one more time. Good. From here, tugging to the corner. Five, six, we're going to do four plus. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. To the other side. Two, three, four, and walk to the other side. Seven, eight. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. And shut. Two, three, four, walk to the other side. Six, seven, eight. Again, shut. Two, three, four, one, six, seven, eight. Chug, two, three, four, and freeze right there. From there, I'm gonna take four chugs going around the half circle. You're gonna chug, 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 chug. So we're chugging to the corner, chugging to the front, chugging to the other corner, and chugging to the side. And you're holding right there so we can reset at that point. Here we go. Chug. Two, three, four, one, six, seven, eight. Chug, two, three, four, one, to the other side. Five, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. One, two, three, four, hold five, six, seven, eight. We're gonna chug this direction. Here we go. Five, six, seven, eight. Chug, 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 walk to the other side. Chug, 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 walk to the other side. Chug, 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 walk to the other side. Chug, 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 walk to center foot and march. Here. We're gonna step to the side, step to the other foot in front, to the front, to the side, side, corner, side, to the corner. Good. Faster. Keep going. You're stepping to the side, putting the foot to the high. Side, go behind. Side, side, go behind. Now faster. Side, behind. Side, behind. Side, behind.
the other foot, tuck it behind. Then you're gonna kick to the side, side. Switch feet, and behind. Good, kick to the side. Switch feet, and behind. Kick, switch feet, place that foot behind. Good, we're gonna go faster. Kick and back, 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 kick and back. Good, march, march. Find your group. Good, from here, we're going to kick our foot out to the front. Kick out to the front, front. Front, 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 front. Good, now to the side. Side and together, side and together. Side, 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 together. Side, together, side, together, side, together. Good, from there, we're going to combine that together. We're kicking to the front. Switch feet to the front. To the side, switch feet, other side. Keep going. Front, front, side, side. Front, front, side, side. Freeze right there. We're going to go ahead and double that. Five, six, seven, eight. Front, front, side, side. Front, front, and side, and side. Front, front, side, and side. Front, front, and side, let's keep going. Front, side, and side, front, front, and side, and side, front, front, and side, and one more time, side to side. Okay, taking it on the other side. We're gonna go slow. Front, front, side, and side, front, front, side, and side. Faster. Here we go. Five, six, seven, eight. Front, front, side, and side. Front, front, and side, and side. Front, front, and side, and side. And front, front, and side, and side. Good, we're gonna slide that foot out. Slide, bring it in to your chest, and kicking it down. Slide the other foot, slide, in, down. And the other foot, slide, in, down. And the other foot, slide, in, down. Good, a little bit faster. Slide, in, down. 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 Slide, in, down.
Yes!
Slide, in, down. Good, from here, we're going to bring it in. Slide, bring it in. You're gonna kick that foot out and behind you, bringing your body around towards your foot, in, kick it down. And then on the other foot, we're going to slide that foot in. You're bringing it in, just as we did before. Kick it behind you, bringing your body to face that knee, bringing it in and down. Let's go ahead and kick it up from there. You've got this. Five, six, seven, eight. Slide, in, out, down. Slide, in, out, down. Good, slide, in, out, down, slide, in, out, down. Good, we're gonna take it a little bit faster. Five, six, seven, eight. Slide, in, out, down. Slide, in, out, down. Slide, in, out, down. Slide, in, out, down. Now, in, out, in, out, in. Out, in, out, in, out.
Yes.
Out, in, out, in, out.
Awesome. Woo, let's start bringing it down. We got to get a little breath in here. You're making us sweat.
Good job, everybody. Give yourself a hug. I want to thank you so much for moving with us today. Thank you for being in this space and for allowing yourself to try something new. And also, I myself am new to the queer community. I am as excited to be here as all of you. And I just truly, truly want to say that I admire each and every one of you
especially those who inspired me to begin to be out and proud. So thank you so, so much, everybody. Thank you for moving with us today. Thank you. Thank you.
You are incredible. Everyone show so much love to Kaylee. Thank you so much. Welcome back. I hope all of you beautiful humans are having so much fun here with your community. It is such a wonderful time to be with all of you guys. Please, after all of that, I'm gonna need for y'all to grab a drink or something. Get comfortable again, because I saw some of y'all like really, really going in. Y'all weren't playing any games whatsoever. Now, as we settle in, let me grab some water real quick. Even though I was sitting down, don't judge me. But as we settle in, we wanna do a special giveaway. So listen and look for your name, because you might be a winner. First, we are giving away a year of Movement Genius plus 3 affirmation albums and huge shout out Allison's ebook, Mind, Body, Pride, to 5 people. And the winners are y'all ready? Kaylee Nadeau, Kimberly Kennedy, Kate W, Start the Wave, and Stasia. Huge shout out to our winners. You guys are incredible. I hope you guys were listening and looking out for your names. But huge, huge, huge congrats to all of you guys. That is everything. You will receive a message in your email to follow. Allison, where you at, girl?
Yes. And again, for anyone who wants access to the tools, I'll drop our super wild deal of $10 for an entire year. By the way, that changes January 1st, so please do not miss this deal. Okay, so now it's time to get into our community Q&A. You've submitted incredible questions, and I'm excited to dig in. I want to be mindful of everyone's time, so we'll cover as many questions as we can. If we don't get to your question, we can also have a follow-up email where we share more resources. So today's Q&A is going to be moderated by Nadia Okamoto, and Nadia is a social entrepreneur and the founder of August, which makes sustainable, ethical, personalized period care. And then Blair and Ruba and I will be chiming in, answering your questions. This is essentially like having a whole queer family who has your back. So as a reminder to us speakers, please be sure to announce your name when you speak, since there will be a lot of voices now. Okay, Nadia, take it away.
Hi, y'all. So excited to be here. I'm just gonna dive right in because we have a lot of questions to go over. So we're gonna talk a little bit about family and body image and coming out. And it seems like y'all had questions about existing in the workplace and thriving there too. So first question I have is, what tips do you have for setting boundaries with homophobic, racist, sexist family members?
Blair.
Yes, indeed. Blair here. I think that the best boundary, right, is to not have to be around that. But like I said before, we live in the real world, and oftentimes we have to be around people because of our circumstances that we would be healthier to not be around. The first thing is to affirm that you don't deserve that and you don't have to be around that, or you shouldn't have to. But if you do have to, it's to not want to talk about things. I remember I was in a conversation once with a family member who decided to be really Islamophobic. And they started talking about all types of nonsense that I won't repeat here because it's not worth repeating. And I just decided and said out loud, I'd rather not have this conversation. I'm getting pretty tired. Being tired is one of the best cop-outs that you can have in a circumstance where you don't want to be engaging in a conversation, that or blaming it on anything else. I'm feeling pretty bloated from all the turkey and the mashed potatoes. I'd rather not. That usually can get you out of it. Also, having to help folks in the kitchen, if it's happening in the kitchen, making sure that the people not in the kitchen need refreshments. Having those excuses rehearsed and ready to go are fabulous. Also, if somebody makes a racist or homophobic joke, be like, oh, I don't get it. My mom is the queen of this. She does it so flawlessly. She would actually do it with us when we were trying to make inappropriate jokes. She would just act like she didn't get it, and that would diffuse it immediately. I think one thing that's really important is that sometimes when we do our social justice or our anti-racist education, oh, this is a great point from Sand. When somebody makes an inappropriate joke, you can say, what do you mean by that? And then you have to make the person explain it. This can be a little bit more inflammatory, but it's something to have in your tool belt. As we do our anti-oppression education, sometimes we feel like we have to confront everyone. You know, somebody says something problematic, it is your job to fix it. That's not true. It is your job to survive. So if that means laughing along at an inappropriate joke, just so you can get out of that situation, I look at it like being catcalled. If somebody catcalls you, you don't always have the opportunity to say, hey, actually, I don't appreciate being objectified. Can you stop? Sometimes we have to be like, oh, hey, thank you. Do whatever you need to do to get out of the situation. And just remember that it doesn't compromise your values. It doesn't compromise who you are. You just need to get out of the situation. So be patient with yourself and remember that you shouldn't be having to go through this in the first place, even if you literally have to.
Thank you for that, Blair. This is Allison speaking. Something that I've found helpful is my notepad in my phone. And a lot of times I don't necessarily know what to say or how to say it in response in the moment, but being able to have almost like a place to dump the things that happen so I'm not holding on to them. I'm careful to not let this be something where I'm pointing out someone's flaws or the things they're doing wrong that hurt, but more so just a way to like discharge that energy and let it go. Because sometimes I can't tell the person in the moment, or, you know, you're in situations where if you actually said something, you're like, this is going to start a huge thing. And I don't really want that whole fiasco. So I use my phone a lot as like a journaling place. And I'll just like jot it down, and then that's a reminder to like reset, shift. And Blair actually taught me this as well. You can have an ongoing group chat with some friends that's like kind of your lifeline. And if you're sharing memes or you are just like, ugh, emoji, like send help, you know, then you at least feel like you're less alone in that environment. So it could be a sibling, it could be, you know, someone you know, it could just be honestly like a content creator you follow. You can literally have Ty's page just pulled up on your phone just to be like, I'm not alone in this. So that's one way that I approach situations. Ruba, did you want to chime in or you want to keep going?
Let's keep going. You guys covered it beautifully.
Allison, if I can chime in really quick.
Yes.
This is Blair again. So hilariously, when I was in the situation where a friend of mine was misgendering other friends of mine, and he said, well, they is just not grammatically correct, I was like, actually, there's a Smarter in Seconds episode just about this. I happened to be the creator of Smarter in Seconds. It was very convenient. I pulled it up. It was 30 seconds. Very quick and easy way, the conversation didn't come up again. And I know a lot of people do this in their lives with my stuff, but it was cool to do it in my life with my stuff. So pull up some educational resources, go on Reddit, go on Instagram, TikTok. If somebody's genuinely open to learning and you don't have the stuff, it's okay to pause and seek out resources so you can present things without feeling like it's your job to come up with things off the top of your head. I literally made the thing and I had to refer to something else. It's totally fine.
This is Nadia talking, and I love that Allison, I also do the notes thing, because sometimes you just don't have enough emotional energy, and I very much believe in chosen family, not necessarily sticking with biological family. So I'm not in touch with most of my extended family, and I think it's only been for the better. Curious, what are the best ways to describe queerness to younger family members?
Ooh.
Besides sharing a Smarter in Seconds video.
Okay, this is Allison speaking. I would love if everyone here wanted to drop a couple words of how you describe queerness. I would love to do this as like a family answer. Because I would love to see, like, how do you describe queerness?
Blair. This is Blair. And as people add those, I think the biggest thing is that with adults, sometimes we feel like we have to explain something that people already understand. But with young people, they don't have a baseline. So to them, everything is new. So remember that you're not unlearning with young people, but you're just learning, which is very exciting. And kind of anything you tell them is going to be okay. Blair, I remember when I was, sorry.
Blair, say it again for the people in the back. I just want to say this really quick. Yes, when trying to explain your queerness to younger people, they get it immediately. It's like, you know, I was with my little niece and she was like, oh my God, your nails are painted. I said, yeah, I love this color. She was like, oh my God, me too. End of discussion. You know, so exactly what you said, there really is no baseline when it comes to young people. You know, you're just living your life. But if you somewhat have to explain your queerness to adults who are well-formed, I would just say, live your life out loud. You know, at the end of the day, I really believe that they wish that they had the courage to be as bold and fearless as the queer community is. So continue to be that person, live out loud, swing from chandeliers, do what you want, as long as it's not hurting you or anybody else.
This is Allison speaking. I wanted to note that Josh put a wonderful bell hooks quote in the chat. If anyone wants to read what's going on there, I'll read it. And then I'll throw it back to Blair. I know you had more thoughts on this. So the bell hooks quote reads, "Queer not as being about who you're having sex with, that can be a dimension of it, but queer as being about the self that is at odds with everything around it and has to invent and create and find a place to speak and to thrive and to live." Blair, how would you describe queerness?
Well, I think that this is Blair. One of the best ways to explain things, and I do this with my Smarter in Seconds, what clicked with you when you first understood it? Tap into that. At one point, none of us knew that a laptop was called a laptop. We all had to learn that. What clicked for you? I think about my Uncle Darren. I was making a character for him on The Sims, and I gave him a wife because heteronormativity. And he goes, actually, I would like a husband. And I was like, Roger that, my bad. And he was like, but I want him to be a little chubby. And I was like, Roger that as well. Let's unlearn fat phobia as well, Uncle Darren. And to me, that was just it. And as an adult, I was like, wow, 5D chess. Oh my gosh. But at the moment when I was a kid, I was just like, oh, got it. Some people or somebody else said in the chat, I think it was Carissa, that, you know, some girls like girls, and that's how you can explain that to kids, and they'll generally accept it.
Agreed. Well said.
This is Nadia talking. And yeah, I guess for me, the way I describe it to like people who are much younger and maybe haven't been exposed to someone that they would identify as queer, or they haven't really learned the language yet, I really like having an open conversation in kind of talking about, you know, what do you expect people are attracted to? Or, you know, when they think of marriage, what do you expect? And kind of trying to describe that expectation as a societal norm, but kind of deconstructing that, no, that there are actually many other possibilities. And, usually anything outside of that in terms of not being cisgender or not being heterosexual is queerness. And so it's a very fluid and open term. And I think that that usually opens up some really, you know, important conversations. I'd love to chat a little bit about body image. And so on the theme of movement genius and, you know, really healthy moving, someone asks, looking for healthy movement suggestions during the holidays that doesn't represent cultures, starve yourself before you eat massive meals or work out until you burn out messages.
Yes, this is Allison speaking. I, as someone who has had quite an interesting and tumultuous relationship with my own body over the years, I really encourage all of us to, let me actually speak for myself only, and if it's helpful, please feel free to use it. When it comes to meals, I found that holidays tend to over-exaggerate food as comfort and positivity. But if you have fear around it, that can amplify the fear. And so a phrase that I would use during holidays while I was in recovery from some food-related behaviors was, food is neither friend nor foe. Food is just fuel. It is fuel. And if it's something that is nourishing, it's something that you enjoy eating, you know, I hope that you feel like you have the space to do that. But that was a mantra for me that helped neutralize the pressures around mealtimes, even just around portions. Like, you are in control and you have agency over your body. It may not feel like that, and the messages may not seem like that, and there may be real pressures around it. But in that moment, I try to remind myself, like, this day is literally like any other day. It's just the meaning we're assigning to this day. So if something is causing more anxiety, that was a mantra that was helpful for me with food. And then with body and movement. Movement is a gorgeous, helpful, regulating, de-stressing option that we have. So if you're on Movement Genius, we have this specific series called Affirmation Workouts. And instead of being like no pain, no gain, push yourself to your limit, it's more focused on how are you feeling right now. It's only 15 minutes, so it might be a way to like mentally and physically prepare for what you're about to get into, or to de-stress after a family situation. But I would definitely encourage you to check out some of our movement classes because they're focused on meeting you where you are in that moment, and there's no expectation of a single destination or you know, pressure to feel or look a certain way. And I think that freedom is really important. So yeah, if anyone else wants to add, or we can keep it moving for timing.
I just want to say this really, really quick. Mm-hmm. Everyone who is here, all of you beautiful humans, please just listen to your body. I have been in a space where I was like, oh my God, listening to so many different people and their advice on how I should look, the type of workout regimens and the things that I should eat. I listened and listened and listened, and it never worked until I stopped, quieted all the noise, and truly listened to my body. At the end of the day, there is someone for everyone. You will not be liked or loved or desired by everyone, only the right people. So keep that in mind. Don't try to be, you know, the girl that you see on Netflix or the guy that you see on social media. Truly cultivate who you are as a human being, and the right people will show up. The end.
And this is Blair briefly. I was able to work with Jessamine Stanley on Too Smarter in Seconds, one that exercise is not punishment, food is not a reward, and fat phobia and fitness. I have been working on my core strength. That doesn't mean that I want a flat tummy. It means that I want to have core strength for my back. I want to make sure that I can like lift my luggage into the carry-on over things specifically. And really affirming while you're work, like, you know, I'm working out, I'm moving, because movement is fun, movement is exciting. And something that Yale added in the chat, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing your name correctly, I apologize if I'm not, is around like texture. One thing that's been really helpful for me with food is touching the food. Like, it's very colonial that we use these implements to touch our food. If you need to touch your food to like get into that like mind space of eating, or thank your body for giving you a hunger cue, instead of being like, oh no, I'm hungry again, be like, thank you for taking care of me, body. I will eat, because food is fuel, and really reframing those things. But Allison is absolutely amazing with Movement Genius for movement related healing. And there's so many resources out there. You're truly not alone. And a lot of us are going through the same stuff.
As a little add on to this question too, what do you do when family members make comments about your body?
This is Blair. I dealt with this very recently via my father, who I love. He's 72. He's very exercise focused. He works out in the pool every day at 5 o'clock. And when his encouragement came from, hey, Blair, I want you to get active with me, to, hey, Blair, your clothes aren't fitting the same, I really set a very strong boundary. I waited until it wasn't actively happening to be like, hey, Dad, at the end of the day, I don't feel like working out. My body is changing. I'm okay with it. I don't want to talk about my body. That's also because I'm not financially dependent on my dad. Sometimes we're financially dependent on the people who are saying things about our bodies. So it's really determining those types of things. And sometimes it's that group chat, aspect that I was talking about with Allison, having somebody else that you can vent about it. But it sucks. It absolutely sucks. We absolutely don't deserve it. Whether it's a family member saying you have too much acne, or you gained weight, or you lost weight, nobody wants to hear it. I think one of the things that I do to really make myself feel grounded is to say, I'm not going to be this person to other people, even if I'm experiencing this from other folks. Sometimes you can't solve it in the moment, but you can resolve and commit to being different. And that makes me feel empowered.
This is Allison speaking. So go with me into my slightly odd way of coping sometimes, which is, if comments at face value feel a little hard to stomach, I try to listen through what they're saying to the story that's driving that thought process. And it becomes this almost game of, you know, privately analyzing the ideas that are running the show in their mind, instead of like isolating them as being like speaking to something and saying they think this way 100% of the time. I try to actually stay curious and listen for the same myths and media messages and cultural standards that have influenced them as well. And it helps me have less judgment towards them specifically, and almost more of a shared understanding that all of us are facing these systemic norms and pressures and industry standards that are skewed. So for those of you who like to, like, I'm just being candid, sort of a like a mild dissociation in the body, and it's more just like I go upstairs into the attic and I start listening and start wondering, thinking, what story is driving them? And I hold that with compassion as well. That's been a way for me to take some of my parents' comments less, to heart. Because also it's not just the negative comments, it's the positive ones when you're being rewarded for things that you're like, that's not healthy either. So I try to like really create distance and just listen, have compassion. And then like, again, after I go to my journal, I write it and then I put it in the trash at the end of the day and I let it go. Just come and go.
Allison, on that point, this is Blair again. With one of my family members where I was able to do this, I just stopped coming over for dinner until there was a commitment made to no longer talk about weight. And not just my weight, but their weight, the people on Jeopardy's weight. I just couldn't be around that for the process of healing I was in. Sometimes when we set a boundary and that boundary is not respected, we have to change behavior if possible. And I want to give people permission to do that as well. That I think we've given a lot of, you know, I've given a lot of advice and I think you shared a lot of grace about how we can like process that for ourselves. But if we're in the position to be able to shift it, take that power, shift it, and recognize that like we shouldn't have to endure it. And if there's any remote possibility you cannot have to and you can do that safely, take that.
I want to, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Stand up for yourself. At the end of the day, we have to be our own best friend and imagine what we would want, or basically however you would expect your best friend to stand up for you in a situation where someone is kind of talking down on you. You have to be that person. I was just around my family a few months back and someone said, oh my God, Ruby, you're so skinny. And I was like, well, I like my body. I'm good, you know? And conversation ended right then and there. So just stand up for yourself. That's it.
Love. I'd love to end our beautiful conversation with a question that I think is so important and probably many of y'all might be wondering too. How do you decide who to come out to in this point in time? When do we even need to come out anymore?
No. When was the last time? When was the last time you saw a straight person come out? I'll wait. Live your life. Like for the longest, we've all been taught if you're gay, if you're of the queer community, you're supposed to come out. No, just live your life. For me, I have been in a glass closet all of my life. I never made a declarative statement and said, hey, everyone, I'm gay. It wasn't necessary. So for everyone who is here right now, live your life. There's no point in making this huge statement. Just do you. Do exactly what the straight people do. Live their lives. Live your life. That's how I look at it.
Absolutely. Oh, go ahead, Allison.
Oh, I'll let you go. And then, because I might offer a slightly, you know, other side. So go for it.
So my thing is, I accidentally came out on national television in 2017. It was on Fox News. It's on YouTube. It's pretty good. I watch it when I'm having a bad day. And the way that I came out, I was just correcting him. I was just like, well, actually, because to me, that's what queerness is. It is just an innate part of who I am. And if I have to vocalize that to clear something up, I'm happy to, but I need people to not act like it was new information just because they assumed something. I think that Karamo and the National Black Justice Coalition have done an excellent job of talking about inviting in versus coming out and reformulating that conversation. But I also tell people who are straight and cisgender that if you haven't had anybody come out to you, maybe you haven't made yourself a safe space, because we only give people information when we feel like that will be safely held. Or if we want to Ruba's point, it's not my business to let you know this. You just need to figure it out. You need to not assume everybody is straight and cisgender. That's something you need to do. On the other hand, maybe you do want to invite people in, but they have to make that. So they have to earn it. Remember that. You don't owe anything to anybody, period. And if they feel like that you need to be a safe space, or that they can be a safe space to you, they have to demonstrate that and they have to earn it.
Yes, Ruba and Blair. This is Allison speaking. I want to offer a perspective in case it's not safe for you to come out, or if you're looking for how to test whether someone might be trustworthy. Something that I did when I was still sorting out what to do was I would bring up a topic that had something to do with queerness, and I would see what the person's response was. So it had nothing to do directly with me, but I could gauge how they were speaking about people. Was it humanizing? Was it judgmental? And so I would kind of put feelers out that way while keeping my own cover. And then also there was a period of time where I was working in entertainment. My team said, if you come out, you know, it will work against your career. And I decided not to for a while. And for me, that was an important decision to honor because I was still figuring out how I wanted to walk in my queerness anyway. I tend to be a fairly private person, and my queerness doesn't, like, I'm wearing a gray sweatshirt. It's not a rainbow sweatshirt. And I present as a human. So I didn't necessarily feel authentic about, like, showing up to the city pride as my way of coming out. So for me, it was quieter at first. And then when I decided to make the statement publicly, that was because I was in a relationship with a woman and she felt so unseen. And we had to talk about, like, will she get threats if I come out? And so if safety is involved, like, definitely honor your safety, and know that there are safe places, even if they're virtual. We mentioned IME. IME, especially for queer teens and young people, like, find those safe hubs where you can get the resources, you can get, you know, hear about other people's stories, and then try on, just kind of think about, you know, the stories you hear about how Ruba approaches it, how Blair approaches it, how I approach it, and say, like, which one feels like it matches me and my set of circumstances right now. And it may come a time when at first you were me and next you're Ruba. I want to be Ruba as well. So I think just honoring where you are and who's around you, and knowing that now is not forever. So this is just a page in the story. Where I am in my queerness today, to Blair's point, like 5 years ago, I still had so much internalized homophobia. Like, wow. So, you know, give yourself that grace to be where you are today. Know that it's okay. And in 5 years, see where you are. Might be the exact same place, and that's okay too. Nadia, do you have any thoughts on this final question?
Yeah, I would say I think I resonate with a little bit of what everybody said. I think I was really afraid to, like, I felt a lot of pressure to come out, and I was really afraid to as well, because I think that we also live in a crazy social media time where it can be really tokenized too. And I think, you know, I knew that I wanted to not come out, but, like, live my truth very publicly, because there were moments where I felt like I was hiding something. And so once I got to a place of safety financially, you know, individually, like in my mental health journey, I did decide to say it publicly, because it felt like, you know, I'm not doing this because I feel like I need to come out. I'm doing this because I feel like I've been hiding this part of myself. And it's not to inform other people. It's just so that I can live that truth. But, you know, I think that one of the most important things in terms of just approaching any sort of conversations where you are going to live your truth is, I think, really just letting yourself, you know, feel ready and giving yourself time to. I think that it was maybe 6 years before I said anything publicly and a couple years before I said anything to a family member. And I think that that time that I just kind of was really processing and also seeing that we do live in a world that still has a lot of homophobia. And I think I had to really get my own mental health and my just like confidence in myself and my own learning, especially from an academic perspective, in the right place before I could do that. So it's like knowing your limits too. So very in line with what everybody else is saying.
Yes. And Allison, speaking quickly, I just want to add, Blair's internet just pooped out like a bird and a sloth combined. And so she wanted to pass along, I put them in the chat, their faith-based communities who are inclusive.
Okay. I like that.
Dictionary. Inclusive of queer folks. Because I'm sure many of us here, myself included, have an experience of spirituality and or faith, and that can get complicated unnecessarily. So definitely check out Blair's recommendations. Oh, I think Blair's coming back in. But also, thank you, Nadia, for helping moderate the Q&A. If there were any questions that you didn't get answered that are burning, we will keep an eye on the chat. And also you can DM us on the gram. But I think it's time.
I just have to say this real quick. This has been such a great conversation. And I just want to give a huge shout out and thank you to all of the speakers and everyone who is participating. Now, before we wrap up the evening, we have one more round of giveaways and opportunities to get involved. So look and listen for your name, okay? First, because we know the queer experience can ultimately include, you know, moments and situations that are uncomfortable and unsafe. Everyone here is receiving a year free of My Sidekick, powered by Every 2 Minutes. Now, it is a comprehensive mobile app that empowers college students to combat gender-based violence on their campuses. Their mission is to make campuses and cities of the future safer. And we will send you guys a download link where you guys can log into Movement Genius and in our follow-up email. It's gonna be pretty amazing, I think. Allison?
Yes. Okay, next, from WISP, which provides inclusive, cost-effective, no insurance needed sexual healthcare, from STI testing and treatment to birth control and otherwise. Everyone is getting 20% off using the code MOVEMENT at HelloWisp.com. Throw that in the chat. Just so you know, their entire medical team is 100% licensed, board certified, and located in the States. And an additional special 10 winners are going to get their Break Stigma hat and gift card to their website. These winners are Pine, Christine Grossman, Hannah DeReamer, Emily Steckler, Rebecca with 2 K's, Etsy, Kaden G, Danisha Moore, Cynthia Merrill, and Sarah Kamel. Congratulations.
And lastly, you got everyone who's here. I keep saying you guys, please forgive me. You know, I'm still, you know, getting it all right. You beautiful people. Lastly, it is time for our biggest giveaway of the night. I repeat, our biggest giveaway of the night, a Miraval resort package worth $10,000. That is a lot of money, including 2 nights, 3 day stay for 2 guests in their luxurious Miraval Unlimited package. Oh, sign me up. Round trip transportation to and from the Tucson International Airport. Healthful and flavorful meals, snacks, smoothies, and non-alcoholic beverages. Full access to amenities, including the Life and Spa, Balance Spa, Body Mindfulness Fitness Center, tennis courts, and 3 swimming pools. Unlimited participation in self-discovery, including fitness and yoga classes, lectures by specialists, and so much more. Plus, each guest will receive $175 in resort credit per night during their stay. And
per night?
You heard what I said. And the winner is, drumroll please. Thank you. Elise, they, she pronouns. Congratulations to Elise. Oh my God, that is amazing. Once again, you have just received a Miraval Resort package worth $10,000. Can I be your plus one?
Wow, congratulations, Elise. Congratulations. I love seeing the support in the chat as well. Elise.
That was a deal that kept getting better. Oh my goodness.
I was like, what else? Huh?
I know. I want to say before we wrap up, I know Blair, you're taking off for the night. So everyone give a quick thank you to Blair.
I'll see you on the internet. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Thank you, Allison. Thank you, Ruba. Thank you for helping me, Brandon. Toodaloo.
All right, congrats, everyone. This really has been such a beautiful time together. I wish we could stay forever, but it's time to wrap for now. So just as we close, I'm curious, what's something that stood out to you today? And how are you feeling now compared to when you started? Feel free to share some of those final thoughts. I'm just going to say a couple of thank yous. I want to thank all of the instructors, Ty and Blair and Kaylee and Nadia and Garuba. And I want to thank Brandon and Candace. I want to thank the Movement Genius team that helped make this space safe today. I want to thank you for taking time to join live with us. This is really, really special. And I also want to thank our sponsors again. Please, if you didn't already, please use this $10 code before it goes away. And if you watched tonight and you want to review it again, we're going to send the link to you in the next couple of days. So be on the lookout. And once again, thank you. Ruba, any final words? And everyone, feel free to read the love happening in the chat.
I just want to give a huge shout out to everyone who's here really quick. Kat J, Natalie, Liz, Rain, Mothin, Layla, I love all of you guys. Thank you so much for just being here and just supporting all of the speakers and just being so amazing. And I really hope that this workshop has inspired you guys, have ultimately given you guys some really cool tools on how to navigate this world that we're all living in, and just continue to celebrate who you are. Don't try to compare yourself to anybody else. Just do you to the best of your ability. Truly love who you are. I know it may sound very cliche, very pageant-esque, but it's so true. You know, just keep your blinders on and focus on what you are doing and what you want to accomplish. You guys got this. You're so beautiful. I love you. And just thank you for being here.
Thanks, everyone. Be safe. Be well. Happy holidays. If you're celebrating, Happy New Year. This was truly delightful. I feel much lighter than when we started. So thank you for that. Take care. I'll see you in the live classes on Movement Genius.
Yes.
Looking forward. Peace.
Bye.
See ya.
We need some music. Where's the music at, Allison?
Okay, hold on.
Get it!
Okay. Let me get this. I don't know what are we working with?
Give us anything. Come on now.
Okay.
In the meantime, I love you, Allison. Thank you for this. Oh my God, I think we have a surprise at the door.
Ooh. This is all chill now. Okay, because we're closing in for the evening. All right. Thanks, everyone.